After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.'" Those who were sent ahead went and found it, just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out."
Thank you, Helen. We haven't put the heating on yet. Can you tell? Why don't you just stand up, swing your arms, turn around, talk to somebody, just move so that you don't get colder. So we've exercised our voices as well. I heard somebody just say, "There's coffee afterwards." I half expected it to be gin and tonic or something. It could do with a sherry, couldn't we? Let's just pray as we come to God's word from Luke 19. Lord, as we sang earlier, we thank you for all that you have done, but we also look forward to all that you are going to do, both in our lives and just in these next few minutes. So now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you always, because you are our rock and our redeemer. And the people said, back in 2019, I asked the church family, you folks, some of you weren't here, some questions. Would you like to hear those questions? Yes. That is the right answer. The fact that two-thirds of you said no or nothing doesn't make any difference. I asked you, does God have the resources to refurbish the hop and vine? And you said, you did. I asked, does God have the ability to equip architects, designers, and managers in the necessary skills? And you said, I asked, can God give us more than we can imagine? And you said, I asked, do we have the courage and the faith to dream a dream? To dream of a community hub that welcomes people in all stages of exploring faith and none, so that the Holy Spirit can use us to walk with them so that they get to know Jesus. And you said, do you feel pleased with yourselves? Thank you, Alan. I'm glad you do. Do you know, we should feel so blessed and so encouraged and, yes, pleased, because all of those things have come to fruition. All of those things have happened. And after 4 years and COVID and world pandemics and economic uncertainty and the cost of living and material costs going through the roof, God answered yes. Because everything is yes and amen when it comes from God. And we shouldn't underestimate what we have achieved, what has happened in those years, despite the things that have been challenging. Oh, and we've also put our pews on wheels. And we've changed our gatherings. And we've just a week ago multiplied or duplicated our gatherings so that you are part of the church family, but not the whole of the church family, because there'll be another bunch of cold people arriving in half an hour or so. But thank you. Sincerely, thank you for believing the vision. Thank you for believing that God would provide all that we spoke of 4 years ago. But there's more to come, isn't there? We're either very cold or we're not sure. I'll accept that you're cold. There is more to come. There is more. And we're beginning to see it in small ways, but we have bigger pictures. And so turning to Luke 19, as we've been thinking about finances and faith over the last 2 weeks, and this is our third week. In Luke 19, if you have it in front of you, verse 28, the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Jesus is fulfilling God's vision. He's fulfilling God's vision for mankind, for personkind, to be politically correct, to be reconciled to him. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, it was the final stage of the reconciliation between God and the plan that he had always had, the vision that he'd always had to bring you, put your name in the gap, you, whatever your name is, Helen, you into reconciliation with him. And notice, the King of Kings comes to a royal city on a donkey. He's humble and he's royal. He evokes a distant prophet. The words of Zechariah, he says this, "See, your king comes on to you righteous and having salvation, gentle, riding on a donkey, a colt, a foal of a donkey." Zechariah writing hundreds of years before that actually happened. Because Jesus is a peace offering. He's a last appeal. He's a last appeal to you. Will you make me your king? And it's been interesting this week, isn't it, that King Charles has been touring around the United Kingdom saying, will you make me your king? He's not asking for our yes in the way that I just asked about your yes. He is king, is he not? But whether he is our king, whether he is your king, is up to you. He's king positionally. He's monarch, sovereign, now head of the Church of England, supreme governor. But whether he's actually that to you is up to you. Those in Her Majesty's forces swear allegiance to the king. He is their king because of their oath. Those of us that are ordained in the Church of England swear allegiance to King Charles, or will do. I swore allegiance to Queen Elizabeth II. And I stand by that swearing of allegiance. Will you make me your king? And just notice a couple of things. In verse 36, the people disrobed as Jesus approached. They took off their cloaks and they put them in the road. They disrobed as a sign of honor, as a sign of homage. They literally repeated what happened when Jehu entered Jerusalem in 2 Kings. Read it later. Jehu came in, and Jesus is a new Jehu. Just as Jesus is a new Joshua. Jesus is the King of Kings. And it's a physical act of taking off your outer garments, which I don't recommend just this moment, and laying them before Jesus, which in that ancient Near East culture meant, you are my King. You are my Lord. And in fact, they used the word Lord. The Lord needs it. King and teacher. If you follow Jesus today, he is your Lord, your King, and your teacher. And that is the call to discipleship. And Jesus comes to bring peace to our hearts, to reconcile you to God. And he says to you, will you not have me as your King? Not as an appendage, not as a hope alone, but as your King. When Josh goes off to Swansea, and the Welsh had better look out, hadn't they? I didn't realize there was surfing in Cardigan Bay, but I suppose there is, Josh. You've researched it. What a surprise. Josh is going to Cardiff and there's really good surfing. Swansea. Well, similar. What I haven't told you, Josh, is I took my daughter to Swansea. I drove all the way from Tunbridge Wells to Swansea and she didn't go. I mean, don't be put off by that. Where were we? Will you not have me as your King? That's the choice. And Josh goes to Swansea. He can have Jesus as his King or not. And the fact that Josh has made a commitment years ago, prayed a prayer, comes to church every week, do you know, that really doesn't make a lot of difference unless he makes Jesus King every day. It's not enough to be confirmed. It's not enough to be baptized. It's not enough to say the words. It's about a daily walk, a daily discarding of garments, and especially the rubbish that gets in our way. So King Charles III, in visiting Scotland, Ireland, and Wales, has said, will you not make me your King? And if you just flip through the passages before Luke 19, if you just literally turn a few pages, chapter 18, is a story of the persistent widow. And then there's the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector, where the Pharisee is shamed by the tax collector who daren't even pick up his head and look at heaven because he knows he's wrong and he knows that he needs to be put right with God. And then the rich ruler. And then Zacchaeus, the tax collector, in chapter 19, right at the beginning. Another corrupt official who decides, I will put it right with God by repaying everything that I've stolen and more to make it right. Just flip through those when you get a chance. And you will see that Jesus has been talking about money all the way through to this point. Money, 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 as Abba wisely said. It's money. Do you know Jesus speaks more about money than anything else in the New Testament? Because he knows that money hooks us into a way of life that doesn't make him the King. It makes money the King. Or things that money can buy. So all the way through the Gospels, he says, be careful, be watchful, don't let it be your God. And if you just want proof, he speaks to all those people before he then speaks in chapter 19 about the fact that he asked for everything. Jesus asked for it all. There's that famous story of one of the United States presidents who died, and at the reading of his will, one of the officials said, "What did he leave?" And the lawyers opening the will said, everything. You leave everything. It's a sobering thought, isn't it? You are going to leave everything when you die. Your property, your money, your clothes, your surfboard. You're going to leave it all to someone. Why not give it to the king before that happens? All of us are challenged by this. Kay and I went on a trip on a catamaran off the coast of Madeira a few years ago. And a catamaran, if you know, it has, well, this particular one had two hulls. So there were two hulls on which people sat, and then a sort of seating area at the back. But the really exciting place to sit was on the netting between the two hulls. So you've got the two hulls and then netting and then a sort of conservative seating area. And we sat on the netting, but slightly to the back because my wife's cautious. And the people on the hulls were, it's really interesting. On the way out, it was very smooth, but on the way back, we were into the wind and it was really choppy. And the people on the hulls were doing this, and one or two were feeling quite sick. The people on the netting were absolutely euphoric because they were close to the sea, and the sea was getting rougher and rougher as we turned for home. And then it happened. They got absolutely soaked. The people on the hulls, it was fine, but the people on the netting got absolutely soaked because the sea just came through the middle of the boat, well, the middle of the catamaran. Because we were sat at the back of the netting, so we got marginally soaked. But do you know the difference between those two people, or the two groups? The people on the hulls were sort of mildly excited when we got back to harbour. The people on the netting were absolutely euphoric with joy because of the exhilaration, because they go quite fast. So if you can imagine going on a water slide, time after time after time, after every wave broke, they were euphoric and exhilarated and very wet. So we had the dry people and the wet people. And the wet people were the happy people. Why am I going on about that? Josh, I could see you were asking me. Because some people don't tithe because they say that's law. No, that's Old Testament law. That's where it was, the law of the Old Testament. And that's the Mosaic law, and that's past. Jesus didn't talk about that. Well, actually, you need to read Matthew 23:23. And he said, "You Pharisees," he said, "you tithe mint and herbs. But how about tithing righteousness and faithfulness and justice for the poor?" And then he says an amazing thing. He says, "You should keep the former as well as the latter." In other words, you should tithe as well as being honorable to and just to the poor. And so these two hulls in my head are like those two positions. There's law and there's grace. And many Christians say, "Yeah, but I live by grace. I live by grace alone." And I say to them, "Okay, so how does that work about your finances? How does that work about your garments? How does it work about your possessions? How does it work about the things you do with your life and your possessions?" And then other people will live by law, and that feels incredibly tight and constricted. And so I say to us, why don't we live in the middle? Why don't we know that Jesus said, "Tithe, my friends"? But not because you must, but because you want to. Because you choose to, because your heart says, "This is my response." And those that sit on this side where there's just grace, just free grace, do what you like. Just look around you at the church. It needs maintenance every year. Look at Trinity. Look at our staff. I mean, I know there's some funny staff around. They need paying. Look at our diocese. That needs to be supported with our MMF. Look at our neighbours in Mevagizzi and St. Hugh and the Clays. We support them too in our MMF, etc., etc. So you can live by law, or you can live by grace, or you can sit right in the middle and say, I'm going to seek God's heart. I'm going to seek God's heart for how I give to my church. And can I tell you, that's the exhilarating place. That's the exciting place. That's the reason why we have Trinity to be celebrated. That's the reason why community groups in their numbers are approaching Heather and Rachel and saying, we would like to use your building. Is that possible? That's why there are art exhibitions in this place, because the pews are now on wheels, etc., etc., etc. Do you want to be wet or do you want to be dry? There's a few dry people here. There's a few wet people. Remember what Margaret Thatcher said about the wets? It wasn't very complimentary. I want to be a wet person. I want to sit right in the middle of grace and law and say, I'm going to seek the Holy Spirit and see what he says. I know what the baseline is. The baseline is for me to tithe 10% of my income. Beyond that is entirely up to grace. But the law, Jesus said, not one jot of the law will be removed. So I'm knowing that's my security. So when Josh goes to university and he gets that first fat check, this might be make-believe. What a wonderful thing for him to put 10% aside to give to God and his work and live on 90%. That's the law of tithing. And that's the gift of Jesus. That Jesus said, do that, and then you can practice righteousness, faithfulness, and justice. And so when these groups come, I think one group was a special needs group that are looking to run a lunch. It's a special needs group, everybody. They need a space. They need somewhere to have a lunch, gather, talk, encourage one another, and who knows, maybe even get to pray for each other at some point. Wouldn't we like to accommodate that? Wouldn't we like to do that? Wouldn't we like to bless them? And they say, how much is it going to be? And we say, well, you're a charity. We'll charge you the minimum. Just the lighting and the heating. Well, no heating. And they say, wow, what's that about? And we say, because we want to serve the community in Jesus' name. Yes? Yes, that's the generosity of a church that gives as Jesus calls us to. People are coming. Lots of people are coming, I can tell you. I can't tell you how many people are coming. And you can be one today. You can be one who comes to Jesus and says, I'm ready to disrobe of my things and my money. I can give them to you because... will you not take me as your subject? And Katrina is mincing at the back, as she always does. And she has a parish giving form in her hand, as she always does. And if you want to know more, that's the way to give, to help us cover our costs. But do more than that, to actually advance the kingdom in St. Austell. Will you make me your king? It's also... Lord, will you make me your subject? And the people said,